Joining me there in John chapter 17, we've got South Mississippi well represented this morning, and you may not know it, but to our surprise, William and Karen Clower are here from Crystal Springs, and we welcome them, and then the Lewises are here, Mr. Scott and Miss Paula. Morgan's parents are here, some of you, many of you met them last night and have met them before, but if you get the chance, say hello to them. They live, I guess it's about an hour from each other, and I think the Lewises have even been over to Crystal Springs, the church, when Joshua was down there, and so it's just kind of unique for me to see them all the way up here together when they're living so far down there. If the Lord wills, next Sunday, Justin, the kids, and I will be at Crystal Springs and be with the Clowers for a gospel meeting, and so just a couple of folks that are unique to us this morning, and just wanted to point them out to you. We've been talking about the tongue. As a matter of fact, I just almost and hadn't completely decided, but I guess Mr. William and Miss Karen are making the decision for me to carry this series to the gospel meeting next week. And so now if they're going to hear this one, I guess I won't. But anyway, we've been talking about the tongue and how difficult the tongue is to tame and what a deadly poison that it is. And we began by talking about the T's of the tongue. We began with some warnings, and then we began to talk about the truth and how important the truth is and how we ought to be trying to tame our tongues as best we know how. We then move to the O of the tongue, and oftentimes we find ourselves saying, "Oh, wow," and getting ourselves in trouble with our tongue. And oftentimes we use things like our opinion, and that gets us in trouble. And we use our tongue to be very offensive sometimes. But then we close that lesson by talking about the importance of being obedient with our tongue. Last week we looked at the N and the G together. The negative, the hurtful, the harmful side of the tongue, in contrast to the godly, the good, the helpful side of the tongue. And how James says that with the tongue, verse 9 of James 3, we both bless our fellow, we both curse our fellow man and bless our God in heaven. And he says those things shouldn't be so, but we realize that the contrast or the range of the tongue is so wide. And yet we can go from being so negative and so hurtful to being so good and so godly and so helpful. And so this morning we come to the you of the tongue. And what I've got in mind this morning as it relates to the you is that of unity. And we can talk about unity on a broad scale. Look at what Jesus prayed for. You got your Bible open there in John 17 and verse 21. Jesus is praying for all believers now, and he says that they may be one. He's praying for you and I as he talks to the Father, and he says he wishes, he desires that you and I be one, just as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they may also be one in us, that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory that you've given me, I've given to them, that they may be one, even as we are one, I and them, and you and me, that we may become perfectly one, so that the world may know that you have sent me. You see, God has always desired unity. The psalmist said in Psalm 133 and verse 1, "Behold how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity." Paul wrote to the church at Ephesus, and he said in Ephesians 4 and verse 3, that I desire that you be eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. He told the brethren at Philippi, I want you to be of the same mind, of the same love, to be of one mind, to be perfectly joined together that you might complete or fulfill my joy. Philippians 2 and verse 2. I see God desires unity. He wants us to be united together. He wants us to speak the same things. He wants us to be in harmony and at peace and unified together as his children and as brethren. And unity is very important. But here's what I really want you to analyze this morning. Is my tongue united with my life? You see, it's one thing. I'm not discounting unity among people. It's very precious. It's very important. It's desired, commanded, whatever word you want to use, by God. We need to be united. And I thought about that as the power of a unified tongue together. You know, that we use our tongues together, and how important it is for the world to hear unity among God's people. And I'm not discounting any of that, but I'm just really, my heart set on this morning, is my tongue united with my life? Does what I say match what I do? Before I get there, let me give you a warning. I've tried to put in each lesson it's just from the cabinet of Rodney, and for whatever it's worth, I hope it helps somebody. So here's my warning for this morning. It is that of euphemisms. Now I know how to spell. I know it starts with an E, but you don't say it, okay? So there's your U, right? Euphemisms. That's how you say it, right? Euphemisms, like none of you in here has ever had pneumonia, and I hope you never do, but euphemisms is the same way, right? So there's my warning for this morning, as the use of the tongue, euphemism. You know what a euphemism is, right? It is a substitute word. Basically, if you look it up in Webster's Dictionary, it means that you want to say something that is very offensive, but in order to make it agreeable, you choose a term that is more palatable. Boy, those are some big words that I don't even know how to pronounce. I've been working on it all week. Bottom line is, you can't say that, so you say this. There's Rodney's definition. I understand what the word means. I can break it down for you. The EU at the beginning of euphemisms comes from a word that we get our idea of well or good, and the phemisms at the end comes from a word to speak. It all comes out of the Greek language, in case you're wondering. And so we go to the funeral home, and what do we have? We have the eulogy. That is to speak well of the one who is deceased, right? So that's the same idea behind the idea of euphemisms. It is to try to sound better, to sound together in order to speak in a way that is more agreeable or less offensive. And we use a bunch of them. Just follow me here. Nobody in the room likes to say, I got fired. So what do we say? I got terminated. All right? I got let go. This is my favorite one, I got honorably discharged. You got fired. But we don't like that, right? That hurts. That's offensive. It amazes me, and some of you are in my Wednesday night study over death and what happens after we die, according to scriptures. And it amazes me that I believe the number is like 265 euphemisms for death. If you work in a funeral home, you hear them all. People come in, they say things like, they passed away. See, we don't like death. And I get it. It's hard to say, you know, my dad died. And so I want to soften that up, and I want to make it sound a little better. And so I say, my dad passed away. Or maybe if it's someone that we have confidence in their salvation, we say they went on to their reward. I don't know if we can accurately say that or not, but we do sometimes. That's a euphemism for they died. We say they went to sleep, or they're resting, or they breathed their last, or they gave up the ghost, or here's my favorite, they kicked the bucket. We just don't want to say death, right? We don't want to say they die. Well, we use all of those, okay? So we're all included, but now let's get a little more specific here, can we? Someone is fat. We don't go up to a person, I hope, and say they're fat, do we? No, what Callan says is they like to clean their plate. That's a euphemism, okay? What sometimes we say is they are big boned, right? Or here's another one. Somebody is short. We don't want to go up and say, man, you're awful short. No, we say things like, they are vertically challenged. That's a euphemism. Well, we got them. We got thousands of euphemisms, and we use them all the time. We've also got some euphemisms for cuss words, don't we? Are you listening? Things like shoot. Things like dang. Things like heck. And then we've got some for God, like golly and gosh and geez. And they're euphemism, folks. I'll just say it like this. I've been working on this for several weeks now. And so, you know what I do every time I hear a euphemism now? I say the word euphemism. You try that. Every time you say a euphemism or you hear someone else say a euphemism, you say euphemism. And just at the end of the day, log how many times you've said the word. I'm telling you, you hear them all the time. Not only do you hear them all the time, you might be saying them all the time. I don't know how many there are. Darn. Crap. They're out there. There's a bunch of them. And then what you're doing is you're saying a word that is less offensive and agreeable. It's more palatable. Thank you, Mr. Webster. So as to not say the word. In reality, what are you really doing? I'm just trying to give you a warning as it relates to the use of the tongue. Be very, very careful with euphemisms. Sometimes it may be better just to say what needs to be said. And then sometimes it may be better to say nothing at all. Not even the euphemism. And so figure out, and then again, I'm not saying that all euphemisms are wrong. I'm simply saying you got to be cautious in how you use them and the spirit and the heart and the mind behind them. It's a warning. It's a caution. Use them carefully. So as we come back then to the unity of the tongue, go to 1 Corinthians 1 with me. As we think about the importance of unity of the tongue with our lives and how we present ourselves, and the importance of what we say and what we do and how they match up. In 1 Corinthians 1, Paul has gotten a report about there being divisions among the brethren there at Corinth. And he says in verse 10, I appeal to you, brethren, by the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, jump down with me, that there be no divisions in verse 10 among you, but that you be united in the same mind and in the same judgment. Now Paul is saying, I don't want there to be no division, going back to that whole idea of there being unity among us. I don't want there to be no divisions. I want you to be of the same mind. I want you to be together and on the same page. But I want you to notice what I skipped in verse 10. That all of you, King James Version, speak the same things. But all of you, English Standard Version, agree. And the idea there is that there be an agreement audibly. And you don't get that in some of the newer translations. But the Greek behind it is that there be the same sound going forth from you that is in harmony not only with one another, but is in harmony with the Lord. That you be of this one mind that Paul talks to the Philippians about in Philippians 2, that it be the mind of Christ, and that you be of that same mind, so that as you speak forth, what you audibly agree to speak forth is of the same thing, unified in message. Come over to 2 Corinthians chapter 4 now and verse 13. 2 Corinthians 4 and verse 13, Paul says to the same church by inspiration, since we have the same spirit of faith, according to what has been written, 2 Corinthians 4 and verse 13, I believed and so I spoke. Paul starts here by saying, using the personal pronoun I, what was internal in my belief system, that is what I spoke. That is how I communicated. My words paralleled my actions. My mouth echoed by my behavior. I believed, and what I was firmly convicted of, I spoke. I conducted myself that way. And then notice the we, at the end of 2 Corinthians 4 and verse 13, we also believe and so we speak. It's not just I now, but now it's the plural pronoun, we. We believe as a group, as a family. We believe, and so we speak the things. Our conduct matches the things. The only thing more powerful than a life unified with its mouth is a group of people, lives that are unified with their mouth. And so Paul is begging the Corinthians to get on the same page, that what we believe might be communicated, and it not just be I, but it be us, it be we, it be all of us. Stressing the importance of unity and harmony with the life that we are living and the lives that we are conducting, so that whatever comes out of our mouth matches. We know what it looks like when it don't match, don't we? We know what God calls it when it don't match. It's called hypocrisy, isn't it? I don't think it's alarming or ironic at all to us that the people who are leaving the Lord's church tell us by almost 90% the reason for leaving: hypocrisy. I don't think it's alarming or ironic or coincidental that the people who are not receiving the salvation of God to be a part of God's family are telling us that the number one reason is hypocrisy. People want to see real Christianity not just from the mouth, they want to see it in the life, in the conduct of who we are. And when we get those two things unified, when our tongue is in unity with our actions, then and only then is our influence powerful in a positive direction. Amen. Close with me, if you will, in Matthew 16. It's already been read. It's Jesus with the disciples there in Caesarea Philippi. As Brother Jim read a moment ago to us, well, we've heard the story. We know what happens here. We often go here to, we say, now right there is Jesus. And down about verse 18 of that passage, he's promising to build his church. And it's his church, and it's singular, and he's possessive of it, and he's doing a play on words, and all of that is so accurate and wonderful. And we've probably heard that a dozen times. What causes Jesus to look at Peter and use that pun and tell Peter upon this rock he would build his church? What brings that whole discussion to be? Starts in verse 13. And Jesus asked him a question. Who do men say that I am? Who do people say that I am? As you guys travel around, what are you hearing from the tongues of people? And they begin to give answers, don't they? Some say John the Baptist, and others Elijah, and others Jeremiah, and others one of the prophets. Who does the world, what does the tongue of other people look like? What is on the tongue of everyone else? That's where Jesus starts. He's looking at his disciples, but he says, who do people say that I am? Let me tell you what's wrong with your tongue. Let me show you what's wrong with the tongue of people in the world. Let me show you how they're saying the wrong things and how they're getting it all wrong. And they began to answer very, very quickly. I don't know, maybe they started shouting, you know, answers out at him. And Matthew's recording the answers here. Did Peter say some Elijah? And did John say one of the prophets? And did they just start answering as a group discussion here? And Jesus says, but who do you say that I am? Isn't that the question he really wanted to ask? Absolutely. But he didn't start there, did he? No, he started with the broad question. Let me ask you, what's wrong with the people's tongue that you work with? You want a notebook? Because I know a sheet of paper ain't going to be enough. I'll give you a notebook. Could you just make a list for me of what's wrong with the people you work with and their tongues? I mean, you could write all day, couldn't you? And we'd have notebooks full by evening service tonight. Now, let me ask you, what's going on in your tongue? You just need a little post-it note? Just a little sticky note? How could you have it done by tonight? Or would it be later this week? You see what Jesus is doing? I want to know what you say. But before I ask you that question, let me get you to thinking, what do people say? Who do people say that I am? Now, let me ask you, what does your tongue say? And he's asking them, plural, what do ye say? Or who do you say that I am? And Peter speaks up for the group. He's asking all of them. I would like to think that in verse 14, several of them answered. They said, not just one talking, but they talked, giving him these options. But then in verse 16, it's only one talking. What happened? Everybody was ready to engage in the conversation about everybody else. But only Peter wanted to get real with the tongue of the disciples. Who do you guys say that I am? And Peter answers, and you know poor old Peter, he gets it wrong several times, but not this time. He gets it right. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. That's what transpires, or that's what brings about Matthew 16 and verse 18. Jesus, what are you really asking? What I'm really asking is, who do you say that I am? Who do you say? Who disciples, who do you say? Not those people out there, but you. Who do you say? What does your tongue say about Jesus the Christ? And let me ask you, is it in harmony with what your behavior says? Is it unified with how you live? If it's not, you're losing your influence and your power for the message of Jesus. Ask yourself, who does my tongue say that Jesus is? You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. But then ask yourself, who does my actions say that He is? They're not the same. You need to get them unified. It's imperative that you get them together and get them in harmony with one another. And maybe that is that you need to come and accept the blood of Jesus, to use your tongue to confess Him before men, willing to live a life that is consistent with what He's asking. It may be this morning that they're not in harmony. You want to get them unified. You got to get them unified. We need you to get them unified together. You may need forgiveness publicly in order to do that. If so, would you come as we stand and sing?